from Conrad Public Library. And oh, by the way, if you have more than one person with your group, would you send me a quick email and let me know that so that I can make sure they get credit for attending today? So if you're all set, Jenny Jo, I'm going to go ahead and introduce you.
That sounds good. I'm going to just shut my door because there's some clients here. Okay. So.
And Amelia, I'll let you know when to start that recording.
Oh, I already started it. I'm sorry.
Okay,
oh,
good enough.
And now my bird clock is on it too.
Hi, everybody. So as we're waiting for Jenny Jo to get her doors closed, I'm Jo Flick. I'm here with Amelia, and we just wanted to take this moment to introduce you to Jenny Jo Allen. She's the founder and the current chair of the Park County Human Trafficking Task Force. She's also the Education and Prevention Coordinator for the Abuse Support and Prevention Education Network, which has the acronym of ASPEN, different than the way that we use ASPEN at the state library, but maybe better.
Confusing.
That's okay. There's probably more than one. There's other ASPENs out there too. But anyway, she has worked in the Livingston, Montana area as an after-school program coordinator and with several not-for-profit organizations. She holds a bachelor's degree from Montana State University in applied psychology with a minor in health and human services. I got all this information off the ASPEN website, Jenny Jo. And I invited you here today because I really thought libraries might like to hear about the Red Sand Project and some of the things that you are doing and our other organizations in Montana are doing to build public awareness about human trafficking. So I can tell you from listening to Jenny Jo, she presented to an advisory group that I've been sitting on, that she is absolutely passionate about the role that we all can play in addressing human trafficking in our state as both concerned citizens and information providers. So with that, Jenny Jo, I'm gonna turn things over to you.
Thank you, Jo. And I hope that everything goes well today. Drive safely.
All right, I'm gonna sign off everybody, but have a great webinar and I'll get everything posted and uploaded over the weekend.
All right, thank you. And I'll just make one little correction. I am the co-chair of the prevention committee, not the whole task force. So Janella Johnson's the task force chair, and I will give you her contact information at the end of this presentation as well. We do have, we are really, really new, and I'll go into that a little bit in my presentation. So we've created a coalition. We have an MOU with the Gallatin County Human Trafficking Task Force. And it's a good thing because they have some more experience. They've been able to guide us and help us so that we're not having to recreate the wheel. But we are very, very different communities, as you can imagine. Gallatin has Bozeman in it, and Park County has Livingston in it. And they're much different towns. So we do handle things a little bit differently, but it is really nice to have that collaboration. So thanks everybody for joining us today. I'm going to go ahead and start sharing my screen, and Amelia is going to be monitoring the chat. So Amelia, feel free if there are questions at any time in the chat, you can just, I can pause anytime. I don't have to wait till the end. Okay. I'm trying to move my little bar so I can present. Where is my? Sorry, I can't get to my button here.
Jenny Jo, is it your Zoom action bar that's in the way?
Because yes,
if yeah. You like just click on it and drag it down.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. That's good to know because that's
I've had that issue.
Yeah,
yeah. That's so you should just stick it at the bottom.
Yeah,
and you know, hopefully it's out of the way there.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, I'm like, this is not good because it usually isn't that long. That's a really long bar. All right. Well. Why is it? No. It's telling me something else. You're screen sharing. Yes, I know I am. There we go. Okay. So one of the things that has been really difficult in Montana, or reaching people in Montana about human trafficking, is the identification of human trafficking, what that actually looks like, because there's so many myths out there. So today we're going to be talking about what are some of the signs of trafficking, and so that you can be aware of it in your area, and the challenges to not just recognizing trafficking, but reporting trafficking, or getting help for a survivor of trafficking. And then I'm also going to talk to you about Human Trafficking Awareness Month, which starts January 1st and is the month of January. January 11th is the National Day of Awareness for Human Trafficking. So even if you're not able to do something throughout the month, hopefully we can figure out something for you to do to help with bringing awareness in your community on January 11th. And then I also have a great book list for you. Our library here is going to have a display for Human Trafficking Awareness Month, and they're getting all of the books that I have on the list for you. And I will be sharing my slide deck. So Joe's going to email that out to you after the presentation. And so if you want to order these books too, to have in your library and some kind of display to just bring awareness to Human Trafficking Awareness Month, that would be great. There are also some documentaries and things like that that I can share with you if you're interested. So I am from Aspen, so I get paid to do the work on the prevention committee of the Park County Human Trafficking Task Force through Aspen. ASPEN stands for the Abuse Support and Prevention Education Network. And some of the things that we do is we provide legal advocacy. We can help with writing parenting plans. If somebody is trying to get out of, or not even just getting out of an abusive relationship or a human trafficking situation or sexual assault or anything like that, they don't have to be necessarily ready to leave. They might just want a safety plan. And because a lot of times survivors are, they still are in love and they want to maintain the relationship. They just don't want the person to abuse anymore. And so coming to terms with the fact that we can't force people to not abuse, we can't change other people, that sometimes takes some time. And so we work with people all throughout the process that they need for, we really meet them where they're at, so that if they are not ready to leave, we aren't pressuring them to do that, but we're meeting them where they are. So hopefully they can be safe while remaining in that abusive relationship. It's not ideal, but again, it is what we can do to help, at least the safety aspect, to reduce lethality in these situations. So I also do the prevention education. This is part of that, but I also teach in schools, law enforcement, medical providers, those kinds of things. So we have that. We do have a safe house. We just purchased a new safe house that's amazing. And it is... our community has given us so much support. We were able to pay it off in 10 months, which is incredible. So if you do have survivors and you are like, I don't even know where to start, I'm going to go through here and give you some resources, but we are also a resource. Most of our clients are from other areas because they want to get out of the town that they're in, especially when you're in a small town and everybody knows everybody. Oh, and that this logo here, the tree, the trust, respect, empowerment, and empathy, that's what we call the prevention education program that we do. So this is me, my contact information And then we have a 24/7 hotline. So anytime, if it's during work hours, we have our staff is answering the support line. And after hours, we have trained advocates. And then on the weekend, we also have staff answering. So we will answer the phone all hours of the day. And we do get calls from the national hotline and the Montana hotline as well. And we're the first name on the directory most of the time. So we get a lot of calls, even if they really would be better off, like they're trying to get a hold of somebody in Great Falls or something. We can still help connect them to those people. Our service area at Aspen is Sweetgrass, Park, and Marr counties, but we will help people outside of our service area, especially if they've tried the agency in their area and that agency is full. So I'm going to do a quick run through of human trafficking. I know a lot of you are probably aware, but there are some myths that sometimes slip into or sneak into the mainstream. And so that people may think that they understand what human trafficking is, but hopefully they haven't been believing a myth that's out there. One of the things I think is really interesting is that some of the people who even are working to fight trafficking, like law enforcement or the military, they oftentimes have a different idea of what human trafficking is. It's like they've been told that it's this kidnapping, chaining up, and taking with force against their will, and that they have to cross a boundary, a land boundary of some sort, and that's not true. There is a difference between smuggling and trafficking. So smuggling is when a person, here, let me get my actual definition here so I don't, okay, so human smuggling is defined as the importation of people into the United States involving deliberate evasion of immigration laws. This offense includes bringing illegal aliens into the United States, as well as the unlawful transportation and harboring of aliens already in the United States. They are not interchangeable terms. Smuggling is transportation-based and trafficking is exploitation-based. So human trafficking is defined as, for sex trafficking, it's in which a commercial sex act is induced by force, fraud, or coercion, or in which the person induced to perform such an act has not attained 18 years of age, or the recruitment, harboring, transportation, provision, or obtaining of a person for labor trafficking, or services through the use of force, fraud, or coercion for the purpose of subjection to involuntary servitude, peonage, debt bondage, or slavery. It is truly modern day slavery. And we are, I think a lot of us are under the impression that when you're in a smaller town, in a rural area, it doesn't happen here, but unfortunately it does. And it is really important to understand what it entails and what the signs are. So anytime you're wondering, oh, well, is this trafficking, or maybe it's domestic violence, I'm not really sure what this is, or, you know, these people, they live where they're working, like that just doesn't seem right, like what's going on, and it could be trafficking. So in order for the behavior to be defined as trafficking, there has to be one from each of these columns. One thing from each of these columns has to be going on. So if they are recruiting by grooming, and they're using coercion to get people into some type of exploiting them for commercial sex or labor services, then that would be trafficking. So it doesn't have to include all of these things. It can just include one from each column. So if there is a person who is being abused by their partner, That might not be trafficking, but if one of the aspects of the abuse is that they are having commercial sex and giving them all of the money to their partner, or they've been talked into doing this commercial sex so that they can buy a house or travel or whatever. I mean, there have been cases of trafficking with elderly. There was just not that long ago, an elderly couple that the woman, the man was trafficking her to have money to travel around in a little RV. And the woman didn't identify as a trafficker because she was doing what she thought she needed to do to be able to have this life with her husband. And that was definitely a coercive thing. So, and they were in their late 60s. So it doesn't always happen to young people, and it doesn't always look the way that that people think it looks. And coercion is definitely used in most cases. So this is the legal definition of coercion. And one of the things that I didn't understand until just very recently when I did a training with Guy Baker, one of our detectives in Missoula, was that I thought that this took a long time, that they would groom them and coerce them over time. Unfortunately, that's not how it happens for with runaways. Runaways are one of the largest populations of runaway youth are the one of the largest populations of trafficking victims. And they usually get picked up within 48 hours of running away by a trafficker. A trafficker has they're able to identify somebody who's extremely vulnerable, and then they exploit those vulnerabilities. So we were formed, the Park County Human Trafficking Task Force was formed right before COVID started. And we basically, Penny Ronning from the Yellowstone County Human Trafficking Task Force, she's the co-founder with Stephanie Bacchus. Penny came and did a presentation for our community. And our community was just like, what can we do? This is not right. We don't want this happening here or anywhere, but how can we stop it in our community? And so that's when she told us, gave us a little advice on how to start a task force, and we did. And then of course COVID. So we didn't really get going until, I would really say we didn't really start going until this summer was when we really became very active. And we still have a long way to go. And so if you have a task force in your community, then please reach out to them. And you can be involved as much or as little as you want to be. They usually have most of the activities and awareness and prevention activities usually do go through the prevention committee of the task forces. So you could either join the committee or join the task force and just contribute what you can. But public libraries, as you know, are a vital resource to communities, an asset to communities. And so having even just one person in your library staff who is trained is great, but if everybody could be trained on how to recognize trafficking, that would be even better. And if anybody could serve on your local task force, that would also just really improve the community's awareness, because then you would be aware of some of the activities that they are doing or things that they're working on. And then that you could also help the community be aware of that too. The more community involvement, the better. So the Trafficking Victims Protection Act, you all probably know about this. It was enacted in 2000. It has been reauthorized and updated, but it still operates in the same 3P, the three-pronged approach. 3Ps are the prevention, prosecution, and protection. And so most task forces are, form follows function. And so most of them are formed with three committees, the Prevention, Prosecution, and Protection Committee. If you don't have a task force in your area and you are interested in starting one, I'm going to have some contact information at the end here that you can definitely reach out to me or the chairperson of our task force, Janella Johnson. And we'd be happy to share with you some of the mistakes we made in the very beginning so that you don't make those same mistakes. And we can also share materials with you. We'd be happy to do that. There are many federal anti-trafficking agencies, and there are actually 13 different entities. And so I'm not going into all of them, but if you do want to look at more who investigates what, these are just some of the major departments that investigate and help prosecute trafficking cases. In Montana, and I'm going to go into this, I'm going to talk about reporting in a little bit, but I just want to let everyone know that in Montana, our numbers for trafficking are extremely low. And so we only have 2 FBI agents for the whole state. And our state is really huge. So we need more, resources. We need more FBI agents. And the only way we can do that is by reporting numbers accurately. And that has been a challenge. And we're still working on that. One of the best ways that we can help with that is having a task force in each community to help train local law enforcement on the difference between prostitution and trafficking, and also with labor trafficking, getting the Department of Labor and Industry involved as well. And the Department of Health and Human Services, they are trying to get up to speed at the state level here with child sex trafficking. They just really have not understood the familial trafficking that has been going on for a while here. And so when Child Protective Services gets involved, oftentimes it's classified as sexual abuse, but they don't realize that they're actually they're pimping out their own children. And so that they are becoming more aware of what to look for when there is sexual abuse and to make sure that it's not trafficking as well. I kind of already jumped into this. So that's one of the reasons why it's so important to differentiate between domestic and sexual violence and human trafficking. There's got to be that commercial component for it to be trafficking. And because we don't report accurately, this is the 2019 report. The 2020 hasn't come out yet. So this is, if you can see, the white states or the clear states have no new cases. And so this is, it makes it look like, oh, wow, these places must be really safe and not have any trafficking. But the reality is they're just not reporting it. So we are getting a lot more reports in Missoula and Billings. They have really great FBI agents. And so I will give you their contact information here in a little bit too. This is the Montana hotline, and it was created by the Lifeguard Group in Missoula, and they are actually building a shelter for human trafficking survivors in Montana, in Missoula. And I can't wait until that is completed, because one of the difficult things about trafficking versus other types of abuse is that other abuse has shame too, but it's such a strong factor that oftentimes they do go back to their trafficker. There's a major trauma bonding going on between the trafficker and the victim. And so oftentimes the shelter needs to look different. The safe house needs to look different. There needs to be extra precautions and safety elements in place to keep the victim safe. So it is really great that they are creating this shelter specifically for trafficking survivors. And there are other places around the country that we can also help get them to before this place is built, or even when it is built and it's full. So Aspen, we can definitely take them at our safe house. One of the problems that we have is that I don't know if y'all are having the same problems. You probably are, because I think it's really prevalent around our whole country, the housing crisis. But here we really make it very clear when people call us to relocate here that it's extremely difficult. There just are no places in Livingston that are available, and the ones that are extremely expensive. We're on a community meeting yesterday. I was on a community meeting yesterday, and we were talking about the lack of housing. And there was one new rental that became available. It was a garage that somebody is renting out for $850 a month. And it got snagged up by the end of the day. So it is a huge issue. So we don't want people to feel like we're setting them up for failure. We don't want to set them up for failure. And so we do work with some other agencies that are national, and we can help be that like stopgap for those survivors, and they can come and stay with us. And then we work with the national groups to try to find housing beyond that. So we'll never turn a person away, a trafficking survivor away, for that initial help, but we want them to understand that there really is not a long-term solution here until we get some affordable housing built, and who knows when that will be. So that is, and I'm just curious, I don't know, do you want to look in the chat, Amelia, and just let me know if there are other people who are experiencing this and that's a huge issue for them too, or...
There hasn't been anything in the chat yet, okay. But like, I mean, outside of everything that you've just talked about trafficking and getting vulnerable people into secure housing, I mean, just like here in Helena, the housing market is really crazy. And the rentals are also really, really crazy. And I've just, you know, people are just looking for anything and everything, and prices have really skyrocketed. Michelle says in West Yellowstone that housing is a huge issue. Carly says definitely nowhere to live, and even shelters, there are none close by. Kathy in Valier says everything is bought up and rented in Valier. And Cindy says there is a low cost housing crisis in Plains, same in Billings. So I think everywhere is really feeling that squeeze, and it's even worse for people who are, you know, most vulnerable, and like the secure housing, you know, not just for human trafficking, but for so many things. It's such a critical part of recovery and, you know, getting on to a different path in life.
Absolutely. Well, so, and here are, you know, I know Montana's known to be like this independent state where we're like, you know, individual rights are very important, which is great. However, the lack of regulation on VRBOs is really, really ruining our communities, because right, like here, I think there was something like 460 VRBOs within the county. That's insane. And so people are literally getting evicted from their rentals so that the people can rent it out to VRBO customers instead. Those customers don't care about our community. They're not invested. So it is really tearing down the values that we have in our communities, you know. And so that's my, sorry, I'm going on a soapbox about that, but that it really does. The more vulnerabilities, the one way that we can end trafficking is by prosecuting the buyers and by eliminating vulnerabilities. And so right now, neither one of those things are happening.
There is a question. Kathy just answered, but Cindy was asking, what is VR? It's VRBO. It's basically like Airbnb, but it's a different company from Airbnb. So
And there are all different types out there, but basically it's not long-term rental. It's they get more money if they can get multiple people in there. In the summertime here, it's very lucrative. So you also got to think of, okay, well, these people, this is their way to live and make money. Like this is their income. And so what can we do to fix the problem? That's a huge question that I think all communities are looking into right now. And I know you're librarians, and so you guys will probably have read this book. It was, I believe, published in the 90s even. It's called Nickeled and Dimed, How Not to Get By in America, by Barbara Einreich, I believe is the author's name. If you haven't read that, it's an amazing book that was written way before was an undercover investigator. Basically, she was a journalist who left her house, her money behind, and went out and traveled around the nation. This is again in the 90s, trying to make ends meet. And the housing crisis was then the number one reason why she wasn't able to succeed. And also, you know, the lack of the minimum wage being so low and the lack of affordable housing. So she ended up having to stay in motels, which rented had weekly rates that were like $1,000. This is back in the 90s. They were like $1,000 a week. So all of her money was going to housing. And we know that that happens to a lot of people. And this is something that has been going on for quite some time. It's coming to a head right now. That's coming to this crucial point where we really need some help. And so that's one of the things that, like, traffickers, when they are convicted, we try to get as much information from traffickers as we can to find out what the signs are and how to stop it from happening. And one of the things that the traffickers say, because they feel entitled to this, they feel like it's their right to sell human beings. So they say things like, well, I'm helping them out. I'm giving them a roof over their heads. I'm giving them meals. I buy them nice clothes, or, you know, these kinds of things. Well, yeah, but you're doing it with money that they have earned by atrocities, by you forcing them or coercing them into doing atrocious things, acts that they don't want to do. And then you take their money. But they also say, like, that's not their money, that's my money. And so it's very, as far as like rehabilitating traffickers or how to keep, you know, the world safe from traffickers, as Guy Baker said, there are only really two ways. It's in a cage or in the ground, because they really have a mindset of they're entitled to take advantage of other human beings and exploit their vulnerabilities. So if we can try to meet the needs of these vulnerable people, these vulnerable populations, that would hopefully help stop the supply. And then that demand of buyers, if we can prosecute the buyers in a substantial way. So that's where the prosecution committee really comes in, being able to not just prosecute traffickers, but buyers, and stop prosecuting the victims. Because right now it's very much their prosecution goes to the victims, because they're the ones that are putting out there, and they don't give up their trafficker, because they are oftentimes, most of the time, they do not see themselves as a trafficking victim. And I think I have more on that in this next slide.
Yes. So the myths about trafficking, that most trafficking victims are kidnapped and held captive, is wrong. That doesn't happen. They're usually trafficked by somebody they know. And in the more rural areas, it's one of the things that can make people more vulnerable is that lack of refusal skills on the youth's part. Like, they haven't been taught to say no, or that their body is their own, that body autonomy. Or I know in some Indigenous communities, like, making eye contact with an adult is disrespectful, can be seen as disrespectful. And so there are some things that make rural communities and people in rural communities actually more vulnerable than those in big cities, because it is usually somebody that you know that is going to try to groom you and then coerce you into doing things that you wouldn't otherwise do. And online is a huge issue for, you know, children being online and getting groomed into trafficking online is a huge issue, no matter where you're at. So you don't have to, you know, I've had a lot of rural community leaders tell me, well, we don't need to worry about it here because we're kind of living, we live in a bubble. We're in a little bubble here, so we're safe. And that's not true at all. And then if you look at some of the areas that have a lot of tourists, you know, these youth have, maybe they can trust all of the community members. Maybe they have built that trust through their lives, but then these tourists come in and they don't have the refusal skills to stand up to them. So that can be a vulnerability too. There are just a lot of different vulnerabilities that rural populations have than urban populations. So, you know, we're not going to, of course, we don't have subways, so we're not going to be talking to our youth and teaching them about, you know, getting groomed on the subway or something like that. But we do have other places. The library, the public library here in Livingston, is a mecca for young middle school boys, and probably they're probably even younger than that, probably like fourth, fifth grade even. A lot of the middle school boys go there and play on the computers after school, and their parents just assume that the librarians are their babysitters. I know you guys have probably known what I'm talking about, and you're probably like, no, I know this happens here too. One of the issues with that is that we do have a lot of predators in our community, and as most places do. And so those predators have their, it's basically like they get to go there and they can groom, and not that the librarians wouldn't stop it if they saw it happening or they knew it was happening, but you guys have a job, you know, you guys are working a job. It's not like your job is not to babysit them. So libraries can be a place of vulnerability. And then here, this just goes more into that myth about the victims being groomed. And then this quote, I love this quote by Lieutenant Sarah Krebs of the Michigan State Police, where this was in, I believe this came from Rebecca Bender's Mythbuster book. And I'll share that with you too. It's an online publication. And they've literally never had a case in Michigan where somebody was abducted and put into the life of sex trafficking. It just really, it does not happen that way. So like, you'll see ads, you'll see movies, you'll see it portrayed as, you know, this innocent person just getting grabbed and, you know, maybe even injected with something to knock them out or something like that, and then taken away. But that, the one of the things that it makes it even worse, the way that these traffickers do it by grooming and things, is that they establish this relationship. They're very skilled at being able to determine what that vulnerability is in that human being and then exploiting it. So it goes across all socioeconomic statuses. You know, there are youth who maybe
do have a great house over their head and everything they want materially, but maybe they're not getting the attention that they need, and the trafficker can pick up on that right away. So number two, trafficking requires a sex act. That's not true. We went over that. It can also be a labor service. And those are really hard to see. And our state is really behind on getting up to speed with labor trafficking reporting, because we've reached out to the Department of Justice, and they say to go to the Department of Labor and Industry, and we go to them and they say, no, that's Labor of Justice. So we're still trying to get some clear guidelines on how to report labor trafficking. And, you know, I'm going to show you a website here. I don't know if here it is. Here's this website. This is Pilar's Project is a great resource. You probably know about this organization. They also run the national hotline. One reason why we are pushing for people to call the Montana hotline in Montana instead of the national hotline is that we have had some situations where the person did not get helped in a timely manner. A lot of people who aren't from Montana or who haven't been to Montana don't realize how huge we are. And so they think, oh, we'll just get them to someplace in Montana, and it's not where they need to be. Or they are in a location in Montana they need to get out of. And the Polaris National Hotline is answered on the East Coast. So they may not even have an idea of how large Montana is and how difficult it is to navigate services if you're 6 hours away from where you need to be. So this is the different categories of trafficking, and then the different typology of trafficking we can see here on the Polaris Project website. So you can go to this page of typology, and it shows you, you can go into each of these categories, and it will tell you some of the places and recreational facilities, how labor trafficking occurs there. So with the national park system that we have, I'd like to think that, oh, this doesn't happen in our national parks, but it does. So one of the things you might see if somebody's working in Glacier or Yellowstone or someplace like that, and they're coming into the library, and they're always with somebody who won't let them talk, or they don't have their own paperwork. The only place that the address they have when they're filling out their card to get a library card, the only address they know is their work address. And they may not even really fully understand where they are. So those are some red flags with that. So you can see their healthcare, forced and logging, carnivals, remote interactive sexual acts, which they have been able to crack down on that a bit with using AI children that look really real. They just don't have enough agents to arrest all of the buyers. So that is another reason why we need to be reporting. Factories and manufacturing, commercial cleaning services, arts and entertainment, hotel and hospitality. Here with our prevention committee, we do train hotels on human trafficking awareness, and we do get calls from hotels, hotel staff asking what to do in certain situations. So these are probably not really surprising to any of you, especially the pornography. One thing that has changed is we don't call it child pornography anymore. It is child exploitation through media, through the use of media. That's because the children are not consenting. They cannot consent their children. Anytime there is a child involved in sex trafficking or commercial sex, period. even if they don't have a trafficker, if they're involved in commercial sex, it is trafficking, and it is, they are protected, and they, you know, are not old enough to consent. So if it's commercial, it doesn't, like, I know in Montana, our age of consent is 16, but for commercial sex, there is, you have to be an adult to consent to that. So like with escort services, you know, that is, a lot of that stuff is promoted online. And I'm not going to go too much into the online component other than when, oh, can you not see my screen?
No, we can.
Oh, okay.
Or can other people not see it?
I don't know. It just says your screen sharing is paused. I'm like, oh.
Oh, I don't think it is.
Okay. Okay. Good, good. So yeah, that just shows you a little bit of like how many, there are 26 of these categories here, or these typologies. And then the different categories that they can fall into are familial trafficking, where parents and caregivers are exchanging their child for drugs, rent, or money. Talking about the housing crisis, that's happened here, where children are being pimped out for rent. There's also survivor exploitation. This is where runaways really come into play. Homeless people exploited by predators to have their basic needs met. And there's a disproportionate amount of number of runaways who are identify as queer or part of the LGBTQ community. And so while being in that community is not a risk factor, if you don't have a supportive family, or if you come out and then your family kicks you out on the street, then that's why it is a risk factor. It's not because you're queer, it's because your family's not going to accept you that way. So that acceptance is really crucial, and we can help reduce those numbers by education and educating people on youth and LGBTQ community issues, so that hopefully families won't kick them out and will be more accepting. Pimp controlled is probably way more common in big cities, but the Romeo pimp, that's basically a boyfriend who's pimping out their girlfriend, or a husband who's pimping out their wife. And I do know that it does happen. Boys or people identifying as male do get trafficked as well. I am using the pronouns for she, her as the victim, and he, him as the perpetrator, because with reports, that it's 92% of the reports are by those dynamics, but I do know that it's very underreported when those identifying as male are trafficked or exploited in these ways. And that is something that hopefully we can, you know, improve on, making our society more acceptable to, amendable to men or those identifying as male reaching out for help, because there is such a huge stigma against that right now. And then this is Rebecca Bender. She is a survivor. I'm going to just play this short video so you can see her her story. And she is now one of the helpers. She helps train advocates, and she does a lot of work with survivors to help them, you know, reach their potential in their life and get out of the life of trafficking.
I was born and raised in a small town in Southern Oregon, and I was a good kid in school. I grew up in a normal
middle
class family. I got great grades. I was really active in sports, and I even graduated a year early. I was accepted into Oregon State University, and I had my dorm room already assigned, and I was really excited to move up to Corvallis. But that summer, I got pregnant by my boyfriend, and I had to make a real tough decision whether I was going to keep my baby and unenroll from university or get an abortion and keep it all a secret. And that was a really tough summer for me. After I had the baby, I had some friends that had gone up to U of O to go to college, and they had an extra room in one of their apartments. It was at that time that I met a boy or a guy who pretended to take interest in me. I really thought he liked me, and we got along really well. He was really funny and charming, and he had a nice car, and he always picked up the tab. He had nice clothes. He told me he was a record producer, that he had a band up in Portland, and that's why he frequently went out of town. There's a saying that says, when you take a child by the hand, you take the mother by the heart. And I really think that's what happened for me, because I had this new little girl and this man who showed this desperate attention towards her, like he wanted to really help make this family that I really wanted for my daughter. And he invited me to move in with him after about 6 months of dating, and I was really excited. And I brought him down to Southern Oregon to meet my family, and everything seemed fine until we arrived in Las Vegas. He said we were moving there because that was the entertainment capital of the world, and being a record producer and having a band, that's where they were going to get the most gigs and the most jobs, and that's where his job was leading him. So I desperately wanted to go with him, to be with him, and to start this family that he promised me. He pulled up to an escort service, and he said, "This is how it works in Vegas. I've spent a lot of money to get you here. I put first and last on an apartment. I filled your fridge up with food, and you're gonna need to earn that money back." And I felt trapped. I felt like, how am I gonna get out of this? And you didn't know if you were gonna live or die. You didn't know what he was gonna do or what he was capable of. And so it was really scary. I can remember just running through the casino thinking, like, these people don't even have a clue what's going on. They're just, you know, cha-ching, cha-ching, Las Vegas, yay! And they're doing all this stuff, and I'm running for my life. I'm running from a man that has forced me into doing things that I didn't want to do. When you have a trafficker that's waiting at home with your child and says, if you don't bring home $1,500, you're gonna find your daughter out on the corner. I think I was probably more frightened to go home than I was to be in the room. Because if you got robbed, it was your fault for being stupid. If you got raped, it was your fault for not watching your back. Anything that happened to you was typically your fault, and you incurred more punishment for allowing those things to happen to you. So it made you always walk in fear of your trafficker.
All right, so there are some, with Rebecca Bender, there are some religious undertones with her advocacy. So if you don't like that, you know, there are other resources out there, but Rebecca Bender has a really great Facebook page with some interviews with survivors who have turned their lives around and things like that. So it can be a really good resource, especially for someone who might just be in that stage of their life where they might need another organization to help, maybe with going to college and things like that. They can help. And there's also the Survivors Alliance, which is the National Human Trafficking Survivors Alliance, that help also with those same type of things to help traffickers reduce their vulnerability, or sorry, trafficking survivors reduce their vulnerabilities and get on their own feet and not have to be financially dependent on anyone. So some of the signs of trafficking, one thing that is very, very, very common, and this is actually common in domestic violence too, is not having their own ID or their own passport, or their abuser is keeping their passport and birth certificate, social security card, all of those things. So, you know, we oftentimes will just tell the service provider, they'll just say, oh, I lost it, if they don't want to get into, you know, explaining why they don't have their ID. So with that, it's really difficult. You never want to say, well, oh, are you being trafficked? Of course, you're not going to say anything like that. But if they are open to getting help for obtaining a new ID, that's a really great way to help reach out, help them reach out or connect with an agency like ASPEN in your area, another abuse agency that helps survivors of abuse, because we do that all the time. We do that for clients all the time. We help them get a new social security card, birth certificate. And oftentimes they are still with their abuser. They just want to have this so that they're ready to go when they need to go. And that's part of their safety plan, is to get these things. So, you know, if you did have somebody who was filling out an application for a library card and they didn't have an ID, you can just always say, hey, I know an organization that can help you get a new ID if that's something you need. And then, you know, somehow get them their contact information in a safe way. They can be, they can have a tattoo of the crown is the most common one, and oftentimes it'll have the name of their trafficker on it too. So with those type of things, I did see that in Billings when I worked in Billings, but I don't think I've seen that here. But that's just because I'm not in public health anymore. So I don't know if that is common around here or not, but when you work in a clinic, you know, you see more of the person's flesh, and like, you can see the tattoos more. So that's why I would see that in Billings, but, around here, I have not seen that. And of course in bigger cities, they'll have more visible tattoos as well. But we do get a lot of traffickers who come to Montana and takes a runaway or somebody from Montana and then traffic them all along I-90 and back. So that's I-90 is a huge corridor for trafficking. So again, working with Montana Highway Patrol and other Highway Patrol so that they know what to look for and how to interview the trafficker and the potential victim. So you never, you know, a lot of these techniques, they're just learning. They're just getting on board with that training that I attended a few weeks ago. That was one of those trainings for Highway Patrol. And it was really great for me to be able to see how they are being taught to be trauma-informed and survivor-centered. Because I wasn't really sure if that was the case or not. So here is a QR code that you can take a picture of, and I'll also send out the slide deck so it'll be on there. But these are I believe the QR code goes to the Polaris, the national hotline, but these are the direct lines for the different agents around Montana. So you can call the hotline, the Montana hotline, and ask them, hey, I need some advice. Or you can call these agents and say, hey, I don't know what to do in this situation. I'm pretty sure this family is trafficking their children, or I'm pretty sure this husband is trafficking women out of his business, or whatever the situation is, and they can help you. You never want to address a possible trafficking situation yourself. This happened recently in one of our hotels here in Livingston. A person called us and they had, even though they had been trained on how to handle a potential trafficking situation, their coworker hadn't. And they approached the potential victim and they checked out of the hotel and left. So it can be really dangerous to do that, dangerous on the victim's part, especially because if the trafficker thinks that they were talking or trying to get help, they may be subjected to violence and abuse really severely. So that's
Jenny Jo. Yes. Uh-huh. Sorry, there's a quick question. Oh, if I would like to report about local people, would I call police or go directly to the FBI?
Go directly to the FBI. I mean, you can call the police if you want to. They're probably not trained on how to handle it. And if you call one of these numbers and then they say, oh, okay, well, I'll call local law enforcement, it's probably going to be way better for them to take over it. But any type of human trafficking is automatically a federal offense. They are going to get involved if it is trafficking, and it's their duty to investigate, not yours. So the reason I say don't call local law enforcement is because even though local law enforcement has gone through like some training through the law academy, law enforcement academy, they usually are just trained in the general what human trafficking is, and not really, they don't really know how to handle it. And that's something that we're working on task force wise with our prosecution committees, is to make sure that every single law enforcement officer has the knowledge of when they need to contact the FBI and when they need to get them involved, so that they can do an investigation. And of course they have, they also have the ability to help extract a victim if they're wanting to get out of the situation, or if they're too young. The problem with adult survivors, one of the biggest issues they have is that one of these agents will interview a victim and the victim doesn't see themselves as a victim. They don't identify as a trafficking victim. They identify as this person's, you know, partner or girlfriend or whatever. Another huge part is that they're so full of shame, and that shame is not just put on them by society, but the trafficker, of course. You think they're going to want you back. You think you can go back to your mommy and daddy now that you've been doing these horrible things with all these men. No, you're a whore now. You can't go back. And the shame is just so overwhelming that it really prevents them from getting help oftentimes. So these, especially, I know Brandon Walter does this, and I know Guy Baker does this for sure. I don't know Andrew as well, but I know that those guys, they do take an advocate. They have an advocate do the interviewing, or, you know, like a victim advocate at ASPEN or one of the other agencies around the state. So that helps, because most survivors aren't going to open up to a detective. A male detective can be very intimidating, but most advocates are women. I know I'm doing all of these gender-based things that are, you know, they don't have to be women, but just they happen to be in most of our areas. And so that can be helpful, having a plainclothes officer or a plainclothes advocate or plainclothes female officer. That could also reduce that intimidation. One of the problems with what we're seeing is how law enforcement handles even domestic violence situations are not trauma informed. And so they'll get to the house and the woman is hysterical and the man's calm. And so they arrest the woman for the PFMA and not the man. And so we're trying to change that and teach them about trauma response and why they are hysterical and why he's calm, and the power and control issues and all of that. And it's the same with trafficking. There have been survivors who finally got out that have been just like Rebecca Bender. She'd been arrested so many times for prostitution. Well, who bails them out? Who do they have to put up the $200? The trafficker. So that just takes them right back to the trafficker. So that's why I say to get the FBI involved, or, you know, to call one of these guys, or call the Montana hotline, and they can hopefully give you some good information too. Because just even if it's only one officer in your area who's not using trauma-informed practices, that one officer, if they have interaction with that victim, it's probably not going to be good. It's that trauma-informed education is so crucial when you're working with people who are so traumatized. So these are the numbers. And they'll also, like I said, I'm sending out the slide deck. So if you didn't get a chance to take a picture or anything of them right now, they will be on the slide deck. So the Red Sand Project, how can we help? Do we need to take a break? Does anybody want to take a break and go to the bathroom or get some food or something? What do you think?
I think we're good. Okay. I think people are usually pretty used to having an hour long sort of thing.
I just want to make sure, because I don't want anybody to like not want to miss out on something, but they have to really go to the bathroom or something. So the Red Sand Project is, you can see here in this picture, one of our advocates is pouring the red sand in the cracks of the sidewalk, and it represents, the red sand in the cracks of the sidewalk represent vulnerable people falling through the cracks of resources. So when we have, the first time I heard about a Red Sand Project was through the Yellowstone County Human Trafficking Task Force in Billings. They did during COVID, or during the beginning of COVID, they were going to be doing a big Red Sand Project event with like music and vendors and speakers. And that's what they've done in the past, but they had to completely recreate how they did Red Sand Projects because of COVID. So they changed their big, huge event into multiple pop-up events by collaborating with the holiday convenience stores and the Holiday Convenience Store Corporation. It's extremely supportive of this movement and of anti-trafficking work. And so they not only allowed us to use their convenience stores for our pop-up events, but they also sponsored and gave money for it. So the packets of red sand say on the back of them, today, 40.3 million people are enslaved. Red Sand Project invites you to question, to connect, and to take action against vulnerabilities that can lead to exploitation. The most vulnerable people in our communities carry the greatest risk of losing their freedom. And the process of filling sidewalk cracks with sand requires you to be mindful of something that is usually overlooked. The simple act of placing sand in a crack or posting a photo on social media may seem inconsequential, but small actions build upon each other to make transformational change. And then it says how to participate in Red Sand Project, fill a sidewalk crack with red sand, take a photo, and share using hashtag Red Sand Project. So we did a little, a couple of our prevention committee advocates and myself went to Billings and volunteered at a holiday store. And then I did one, the previous pop-up that they did, the very first one that they did as well, so that we could learn like, oh, how do they do this? So basically they had a lot of people, they have a lot more members. So they had a lot of people reach out to different businesses in the community, and holiday stores were the ones who were like, heck yeah, we want to do this. And so that's why the holiday store thing stuck. And now you know, they're promoting these project pop-up events still through the holiday store. So they are kind of like one of those long-term business partners now, which is nice. We don't have anything like that in Livingston yet, but what we did is we decided to have a Red Sand Project art installation, because that is what this started out as. The Red Sand Project started out as. So we decided at the very first art walk, which was June 24th of 2021, the first art walk since COVID began, we were donated a space right on the major walk for the art walk, the major street for the art walk. We were donated a huge indoor space as well as the sidewalk. And we had one of our community, our communication director of the task force. She's also an artist, and she made these really cool panels that people could decorate with sand, and they had different quotes etched into them about this with the statistics and like the hotline number and things like that. And so then that was a huge success. We were able to reach over 200 people. And then we went to the Shields Valley and we did their farmers markets in Clyde Park and Wilsall. And the Clyde Park one, we got over 100. We reached over 100 people. The other one, the Wilson one, that wasn't the best because the day that we were there happened to be one of those really huge smoky days that we had, and it started to rain. So I think 12 people is how many we reached at that one. But those are just some ideas of how you can make it your own, and you don't have to, you know, only do a huge event, how you can do something small on the outside of your library. If you're not open to public yet because of the pandemic, you could even have something just outside or at the book drop or something like that. There's a lot of room for creativity. One of the things we're planning for our next Red Sand Project will be the opening of the art walk again in the summertime, but we have a different space that has volunteered they're donating their space to us, that has it's huge, and it has this really great area for children to play. It's like a built-in treehouse kind of thing. And so we are going to have an art installation. We're going to train local artists. We're going to do this training on human trafficking, and then give them the material, the sand, for them to create art with that sand. And then that art can be sold at the art walk to benefit the Park County Human Trafficking Task Force. And so we're still working out all of that, of course, we're planning on that. But for the Human Trafficking Awareness Month, we're not actually doing a Red Sand event. We're doing other like virtual event kind of things because of, again, the stupid pandemic. That we just have to, you know, dial back a little bit. We are having one in-person screening of a documentary called I Am Jane Doe. It's a documentary that goes into all of the fight that it took to get Backpage taken down. And of course, as soon as it was taken down, another one popped up, another 10 popped up. So if you go on to a website called eBackpage, just the letter E and then Backpage, you can select I don't want to show you because there are pornographic images or naked images on there, but you can select your area or the town closest to you, and you'll see what humans are being sold for sex on there. It's atrocious. But the youth who were fighting this system, they're just some of the most courageous people, I think, out there. So that show, I Am Jane Doe, it is those survivors who were trafficked when they were 14. I think one was first trafficked when they were like 12. But they were trafficked online on the Backpage.com, and Backpage.com really facilitated the trafficking. So that's what that documentary is about. And we're going to have a screening of it. in at the Livingston Art and Cultural Center on January 11th. So you can do something like that too, and just have a registration so that you can make sure you're distancing and, you know, provide masks and things like that. So here is Alexia Reiner. She is our communication director for the task force, and she is an amazing artist, just a really cool human being. And she's the one who created those panels. And we do take them with us when we go to different, when we do these different like farmers markets and such. So you can have something like that too. If you have a local artist, I'll show you too. There's a local artist who is helping to organize our big art event in the sun, in the summertime, but I'll show you just real quick. This is, it's all fuzzy. Sorry, I don't know if it's coming. There we go. It's coming into view. But she made this beautiful, it's still fuzzy. I don't know. It's because I have that stupid background blur thing.
Yeah, I think it's because of your filter. So.
Yeah, it's my filter. Okay. But it's beautiful. She made this huge acrylic, these acrylic pieces for us. And if you can, whatever resource you have in your community, whoever you have in your community who would be willing to, take this on or help you with a project in your library, in or outside your library, would be really great. So this is how you get to the Red Sand Project website to order the sand. And you see when you get here, there it is, Molly Goachman. That's the person. She's extremely cool. And then you would just continue. You go to the sidewalk.
Jenny Jo, I think if you're trying to, right now we only see your PowerPoint. So if you might have shared just your PowerPoint application.
Think you're right. Okay.
Yeah, if you go into your
sorry.
No, that's okay.
Here we go. Now can you see it?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So if you go in here to sidewalk installation, this the earthworks are really cool. This is these are the big projects that they've done here's the U.S.-Mexican border, Seattle-Tacoma Airport, and it goes look at that huge, you can see it from the air. And then here's the International Airport in Houston that has it. And I remember flying over this and being like, what is that red thing? And that's how you get communication started, you know? So anything like this, if you wanted to do a project, this is going to take a lot more sand. And so the sand is free, but the shipping isn't. And so let's see if I can get back to the, so what we do is we buy the sand or we pay for the post, Aspen pays for the shipping. So we get these bags, these are what the bags look like. And we also get a box of 25 pounds of just sand. And then the kids especially, we get these little Dixie cups and the kids love playing in the sand. And so then we end up having usually, like we had at Clyde Park, we had these kids, you know, who were playing in it and making designs, writing their names with it, writing out love and hope and things like that. So you just order the sand, it's free. The box of the 20, about this, it's about the same price for shipping for the box of loose sand and the bags. They're about around $20 for the smallest order, which I think is 100 people. And then of course we did share experience with Molly Goachman, and she put it on social media. She just put some of our pictures on social media and was really excited to see what we were doing because those panels were new, and I should have posted a picture here of them, but I didn't. But the panels were, they were like, I'm probably about bigger than that. They're probably about like 3 feet long, And then they can pour their sand in the etched out statements and things and statistics. And then when they're done, there was a little thing that you could just turn and the sand would fall down and then we would reuse it. So we still have about 30 pounds of sand that we can keep reusing. So that's one way that you can, you know, be creative with that and do your own pop-up event someplace. You could have, when Joe and I were talking about possible things that libraries can do that aren't open to people right now, we were thinking it would be, you could even get these packets of sand and have them like in a bucket or a tub or basket or something, and then have some human trafficking awareness, make some posters and have human trafficking awareness month posters. You can go online and find toolkits to help you with these projects as well for human trafficking awareness month. And then this is the reading list. It's 2 pages. And like I said, I'm going to share my slide deck with you. So you may already have some of these books in your library, but if not, maybe you could get them and have I know our library has a display case kind of thing that they do for different monthly topics. And so you could do that. This one here, The Slave Across the Street, The True Story of How an American Teen Survived the World of Human Trafficking, is really good. It's really short. It's like a short novel you could probably read in a couple of days. Teresa Flores is she is now an advocate, and she has a nonprofit that has a little sticker that goes on soaps in hotels. And so when the survivor, you know, they're not left alone. So when they go in to take a shower, that might be the only time they're left alone, just inside the hotel room. And so they can open up that soap and then have that number on that sticker. So they're not having to bring anything in. It's already in the room, so they can't be blamed for it. If the trafficker does see it. But that also helps them at least have a number to call if they do want to get out of it. And then this, so it's a little bit, there's The Slave Next Door. That is a different book than The Slave Across the Street. So, but The Slave Across the Street was really interesting because it happened a while ago. She was victimized in the 90s, and she lived at home the whole entire time that she was being trafficked. She snuck out at night. She was being blackmailed, basically. They raped her, and they drugged and raped her, took Polaroid pictures, and then threatened to tell her coach, her parents, her pastor, and show them to them if she didn't do these things. And then they would, like, she would, quote, earn back the Polaroids by doing these acts. And sometimes she was forced to have sex with dozens of men every night. And then she'd get up and go to school the next morning like nothing happened. And so just seeing the ways and through these books, when you're reading these books, and you get a sense of the shame that's like current that runs through all of these survivor stories, is that shame. So, you know, the more awareness we have, the more the community can be sending that message. It's not your fault. This is something that happened to you. You are not to blame in any way. Like, that is something that will hopefully change and reduce the amount of shame that these survivors have. All right, and then here are the resources that I used for the presentation today. And if you'd like to know more or need some information about how to start a task force or anything like that, or if you do have a task force in your area and you don't know how to get a hold of them, I most likely have their contact information. Janella and Tara Bradford, who's the Gallatin County chairperson, the three of us went to Helena for a symposium on human trafficking recently. And so we have a lot of great resources now that we didn't have before the symposium. We got to meet people from different agencies and nonprofits around the state. So please reach out to me if you'd like any resources or need specific resources that I didn't mention. Any questions, please, you feel free to type them in the chat if you're not able to talk. It's completely understandable. I kind of ran through that really fast. And it is trafficking is so involved. There's so many things involved in trafficking that it's hard to give a comprehensive presentation on it in a short amount of time. So that's basically like the most compact information I can out there. Okay.
Yeah. Michelle just put it in the chat. Years ago, we had a teenager showing a younger girl pornography on one of her computers and made her stop. She came back later and did again. In hindsight, we believe she was normalizing behaviors, not always men/women to look out for. And, you know, Jenny Jo, I was really appreciative that you kind of mentioned that throughout your presentation, even though statistically a lot of the reported cases do have this skewing towards men trafficking women. It is really, really important that there are a lot of abuses and sex violations committed against men, and it's just not reported, which is really, really, really unfortunate. So it was really good to have a reminder of that. I just learned a lot in this presentation. I mean, when you were sort of like, what is trafficking exactly? I'm like, oh, I think if someone asked me, I would be like, the movie Taken, I think, you know, that's kind of what my mind, that's like the only kind of mainstream media portrayal that I can immediately think of. And, you know, it's as you were saying, like, it's kind of like that persistent rumor of like people putting weed in Halloween candy. There are like no recorded instances of this happening. And there's, as like that quote you showed, there's almost no recorded instances of people being like complete strangers being kidnapped. And then, you know, it's like overwhelmingly people that you know, that you have like groomed, you have developed a relationship with you, and it's people that you trust, right? That vulnerable people are tricked by and betrayed by. So just hearing you talk about what trafficking is, and also like, I'm like, oh yeah, not a lot of people, I understand why people are like, I'm not a trafficking victim. Like, mm-hmm. That's not, you know, I'm just doing this because like it's something important to my partner and something that, you know, I want to make them happy or something like that. And like, that is a much more prevalent dynamic, unfortunately. And that just expands the definition of trafficking.
And it often does start as the person is providing basic needs for the other human being, and there is no abuse happening. There's no commercial anything happening. It can start that way. And then just like with Rebecca Bender's story, like he met her family liked him. Everything was great.
Yeah.
Until they got to Vegas. And then it was like, okay, you're isolated. You're cut off from your family. You're going to do this shameful thing and you're never going to go back to them again because I'm going to put this shame on you. So one of the things that people often call trafficking is, the first step of trafficking is kidnapping of the brain, kidnapping of the mind. Mm. So people will often say, well, why didn't you just leave? Like, you weren't handcuffed, you weren't locked in. Like, why didn't you just leave? There are also stories of, it's not just the survivor who's being threatened. It is their family, their loved ones, mm-hmm. Their pets even. So Trackers Against Trafficking is an organization that is wonderful. It's national, and they help truckers identify trafficking and report it. Mm-hmm. And one of the victims that got saved, or, you know, really literally got rescued by a trucker who called the hotline and said, hey, this is kind of strange. These girls are really young and they're not wearing clothes that are appropriate for this weather. Like,
yeah,
can you check this out? Well, that was something that they had basically been abusing one girl, and her cousin, but they weren't really doing much. They were doing some physical stuff. Like they pushed her down the stairs one time or something like that. But then how they kept them from leaving or reporting is, they threatened one another with hurting the other one. So yeah, they knew, oh, they don't care so much about getting kicked down the stairs themselves, but what if I threatened to do it to their cousin? Mm-hmm. And so that was how they kept both of them in line. Mm-hmm. And or not, I say in line, but you know what I mean, like from the trafficker's point of view.
It's just the amount of control that they have over
people. Yeah,
and like I, you know, just that question. And I mean, this conversation has changed so much from even when I was growing up and I was younger, and just kind of the shaming culture around sex in general. And I do think things in some ways are trying to move towards being more survivor-based, more empathy-based. But that persistent, inherently unempathetic question of like, why didn't you just mm-hmm. blank, blank, blank? I mean,
yeah,
it's just so hard when, you know, ideally everyone is surrounded by people who love them and support them and value them. But if you're in a relationship with people who don't respect you, who don't love you, who don't support you and don't have your best interests, but that's all that you really know. It's like, I know people don't necessarily mean to be thoughtless when they ask that question, but it is, you know, sometimes I'm like, it's just such a different existence and you can't just ask like, why didn't you just leave? Mm-hmm. Because it's so different when you don't feel like you have a safety net, when you don't feel like you have anyone in your corner, when you have to make all of these decisions by yourself and you don't know what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. And I think sometimes like understandably people are like, I'd rather deal with the evil that I know as opposed to open myself up to something possibly even worse.
Yeah.
You know? So
yeah, let's see, I'm gonna just look at the person's name again who put that in the chat. It was Michelle. So yeah, Michelle, that definitely could have been grooming behavior, and thank you for mentioning that about the female was the one who was doing this grooming behavior, because that is, there's a hierarchy in what trafficking, the world of trafficking, they call it the life, and there's a hierarchy in it. And the person who is called, it's a horrible term, but they call them the bottom bitch or the bottom. That person is required to recruit and also keep the others, if there are more than one, which oftentimes there are, keep the other people in line by using violence. So the trafficker's not only, you know, not getting his hands dirty by being out, being the one who gets caught, but they're also not getting their hands dirty with committing the violent acts. They are making another victim do that. So oftentimes that bottom person has been with their trafficker longer than the others. And so they are given this job to recruit. And you'll see a lot when you look at trafficking, like videos, evidence, you'll see them use women in public places to recruit. They don't have to do that with, like out on the streets with runaways. They can just drive right up to him and say, hey, baby girl, you look cold and hungry. Get in my car. I'll go get you some hot food. And I've got a hotel room. You're more than welcome to stay there with me. I don't want to see you out here wet and cold. It can happen like that too. So there was a recent, bust on a trafficking ring. I think it was in Ohio. But the traffickers were using two women to recruit, and they were dressed really nice in like women's skirt suits, looked very conservative and friendly. And they were recruiting from a mall, and they would approach young, attractive women and invite them to their Bible study group. What seems more innocent than that, right? And there were two women who thought it was really weird. And so they told, I think they told the mall cop, the,
I don't know what you,
security guard. Yeah. I was calling mall cops.
Yeah. But,
you know, and then they knew what to do, thank goodness. And they were able to get those women arrested, you know, put into custody and question and say, you have immunity if you just tell us who is making you do this. Oftentimes the victims still won't talk, but these women did, thank goodness. Yeah. And I think there were 13, I think they were able to save 13 people in that trafficking ring. So yeah, it is definitely not like the movie Taken. And that is what is in the majority of people's heads. And so that awareness is so important, and especially in rural areas. So I'm so glad that everybody's here, and hopefully you are going to take advantage of Human Trafficking Awareness Month to get some of this information out. If you need any like help with just even coming up with ideas, I'd be more than happy to talk with anybody or get you to somebody else who's even more knowledgeable and experienced than me.
Yeah. No, thank you so much, Jenny Jo, for sharing your expertise and your knowledge. I think this is really eye-opening for me. And I'm sure other people on this call also learned a lot from it. And I think just even know, like having contact information and knowing who we can contact, you know, like stories like Michelle's of like, oh, this thing is happening. And then sort of like in hindsight, you're like, oh, that was really weird, you know, and we all have experiences like that, where at the time, you know, we're like, okay. And then later on you realize, oh, that was very strange. Absolutely. And something's just not right. And so, you know, at those moments, just like letting people know, and maybe it's nothing, maybe it just was like a weird thing, but like, maybe it is something. And, you know, if people can look into it and they are like, yeah, this is weird, then, mm-hmm. you know, it could lead to something happening. Mm-hmm. So thank you again for all of these resources. Are there any questions from people in the webinar? Any other comments? You can unmute yourself if you like, but I am also watching the chat.
I see that Casey is on from Belgrade Community Library. And so the Gallatin County Human Trafficking Task Force is the task force that we have the MOU with and we collaborate with the most. We call it a coalition, but Tar Bradford is the task force chairperson there. And if you'd like to get involved with them or get some more information or materials at all, I can help connect you with Tara. And you may even already know her because she's been doing this a lot longer than I have. And she's a rock star. She was hired through the Sheriff's Department, the Gallatin County Sheriff's Department. But I don't know what's going on right now with that, because I believe her, the money that they had for her position is up, but she's actively, you know, still working and still doing this work. Mm-hmm. So she has over 20 years experience mm-hmm. in working with anti-trafficking.
So, yeah. I mean, if you want to just go ahead and send that in your materials to Jo, that would just be great to send out. And in case, people didn't hear at the beginning, Jenny Jo will be sending her slides to Jo, and Jo will email that out to everybody this at some point this weekend or on Monday. So you will have access to everything that was mentioned in this webinar. If there aren't any other questions, let's see, Cindy says, I'll be sharing this information with the rest of my staff and paying attention to this is weird thoughts and feelings from now on. Yeah, and just, you know, like this could be a great kind of training topic for a professional development day at your library, even just like just expanding upon people's ideas of what human trafficking is and having that conversation and making people more aware of that, I think can just in and of itself be super, super helpful and educational and just raise a little bit more awareness. Because, you know, public libraries do see a lot of people. You see everyone from all walks of life, and, you know, there might be a chance that you will interface with someone who's in this really unfortunate situation. So,
or even with, I mean, like I'm thinking, I know one of the ways that traffickers groom youth are through the chats in the video games, you know, mm-hmm. and you could even, you know, if you come across this man keeps coming and playing these children's video games, or this woman comes in and plays mm-hmm. children's video games. I mean, even something as small as that could be a red flag. And they're, you know, cause they lie about their age in the chat, making them seem like they're another teenager mm-hmm. or young person. So even something like that is, and I know you guys have privacy laws and that protect you from, giving information about what people are doing on the internet and things like that. So I don't know what your protocol is when you have something like that that's alarming. So please follow your protocol. I don't want to.
Yeah. I mean, I think
not to go against your protocol.
And I think in general, I think with a lot of like children's programming and teen programming, it's like, I know not a lot of libraries that have teen spaces now. It's like, if you're not a teen, you're not allowed in this space.
Oh,
like
good.
It doesn't matter if there are free computers here. Like you're not a teen, so you're not allowed in this space. And like, you know, with the children's room too, it's sort of like, do you have a child with you? If you don't, then you know you're not, it's not really appropriate for you to be in the children's room, you know, like this just room isn't just, it's not for you. But you know, just sort of thinking about, and you were mentioning, you know, like vulnerable teenagers, especially youth who identify as LGBTQ and don't unfortunately have the support from their families and do end up on the streets or are just kicked out, you know, that's another area in which I think a lot of libraries are trying to provide resources to those vulnerable teens. And I mean, being a teen is already fraught enough with the exquisite anguish of adolescence. But you know, like the idea of bodily autonomy of, you know, standing up for yourself, because if you won't, who will? And kind of enforcing those ideas and in general teen programming and kind of empowering them in that way too is another kind of angle to sort of interface with this whole situation. Mm-hmm. So
yeah. And media literacy is another really great way to do that too.
Yeah.
The Getting Better Foundation, one of their staff is on our board. And so they made that documentary called Trust Me.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you've seen it or not, but it's all about media literacy, and it has some really great information. And one of the things that can be really useful when talking to teens about media literacy is helping them realize that they're being manipulated.
Yeah.
Because they don't like that. They don't like what most people don't like that. But a lot of these youth, they've grown up, they're digital natives. And so they don't have the critical thinking skills yet to really analyze the content.
Mm-hmm.
And so a library is in that's a teen room, and a library team programming would be amazing for that. And if you need any help with the media literacy curriculum, I can connect you with Rosemary Smith from the Getting Better Foundation. And yeah, I can definitely help with that. We've got that covered if you need any help with that, with programming, because it does have a lot to do with trafficking prevention and abuse prevention in general.
And also just staying safe on the internet overall too.
Yeah.
You know, that's also just a topic of concern.
For sure.
Yeah, if you can include that in the email to Joe, that would also be great.
You guys are going to get like 30 pages of information. And be like,
no, that's perfect. That's like anything and everything you can think of, please include.
Okay, so I will.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much again, everybody, for coming and learning. If you all have any further questions or comments, please do reach out to me or Jo or Jenny Jo, and we'll try and address them as best we can. And, you know, if you guys end up doing something with the Red Sand Project in particular, please share that and let people know. This is all about awareness. So we'd love to know at the State Library. We can help publicize it. I'm sure Jenny Jo would love to know. This is a really great topic to help educate people on.
Thank you so much. And I forgot to say, you can go to, there is a Facebook and Instagram page for Park County Human Trafficking Task Force. So if you do an event or even a day of awareness and you take pictures, you can send them to us on social and we'll share them. That's exciting.
Yeah, no, and that's the whole point of this project. So
yeah. Thank you so much, everybody, for attending. I am really glad that I had this opportunity to talk to everybody, and I hope you have a great day.
Yeah, thanks so much. I'll stop the recording.